In barely 1 week, that is one week less a day, Friday evening, the people of the Church of God will be coming together around the world to observe Passover, which is a night service. I hope you realize why it is a night service. It's a deeply moving time. It must be held in the evening. It is a heresy if it is held during the day or in the morning or at any other time of the day. It must be a night service. This year, I'm a little concerned because Satan has been at work insidiously in the Church of God, as he does so often before Passover. And a lot of our brethren seem to be losing perspective as we come on down to the week of Passover. And a lot seem to be forgetting and minimizing the work that is to be done at this season of the year. A lot of people are forgetting all that Passover is meant to bring us and to show us, and to teach us and to implant within our minds. And Passover must teach you something specific, brethren. If you don't learn what Passover is meant to teach you, you are in every way in trouble to some degree, and things begin to happen that should not be happening. We need to understand Passover. Well, in far too many cases this year, we've been led by Satan and by circumstances to focus in upon ourselves and our problems and our trials and our difficulties and what is going wrong in our lives. Whereas the ancient message of Passover and the vital meaning of this season is that we must look on beyond our flesh and our problems and our trials and all of those things and the pursuits of this life and remember with respect and with honor and with awe the agony of the dying Jesus Christ. Some of you aren't thinking about that at all. Not at all. You're thinking about yourself. And that's part of the problem. We need to be thinking about the agony of the dying Jesus Christ, whose awful, gruesome, bloody death allowed us to become the servants of the living Jesus Christ. And with no dying Christ, there is, in a sense, no hope of serving the living Christ or of serving the living Father, and of being members of his church and someday having eternal life. Passover is not a time when you look to yourself with obsessive introspection. Now, that's what we do during Unleavened Bread, by the way. I hope you understand that. Unleavened Bread is the feast season when you look to your sins and your problems and you analyze them and you think about them and you determine before God to get them out of your life. That is not the spirit of Passover, which precedes the Feast of Unleavened Bread. There's a little bit of that, admittedly. But the whole spirit of Passover, you see, involves looking to Jesus Christ. It does not, of itself and by itself, involve, of necessity, a lot of looking to the human flesh. Not your flesh, at any rate. Passover is not a time when you tie yourself up in knots because of what you've done. You may tie yourself up in knots, but it should be because of what he did, because of what you've done. Passover is not a time when, you know, we wallow in self-pity, which is what some of you are doing. It is not a time when we allow, you know, waves of self-hate to sort of pound upon our conscience to the point that we cannot maintain our spiritual stability any longer. That is not the spirit of Passover. A little bit of that obviously occurs, but that is not where the perspective and the focus lies. And some of us do that. We get our eyes on the flesh and the problems of the flesh to the point that our perspective goes out the window and the guilt begins to well up, because when you look at yourself, it always does, and that is good within the Feast of Unleavened Bread to some degree. We'll talk about that in a minute. But then I find a lot of members this year, more than perhaps any year in the last 10 to 15 or 20 years, because they are looking at themselves with almost obsessive introspection. They are therefore running in the opposite direction. Not towards the living Jesus Christ, but away from the living Jesus Christ, and especially when the ministers of God remind us of the awful day when the only perfect human being who has ever lived on this earth, I mean the only man who really tried to overcome sins. You've never really tried, you know. Neither have I. Not really. We've sort of, you know, given it a bit of a dab here and there. And some of us have sort of gotten a little uptight about sin from time to time, but Jesus Christ didn't get sort of uptight about it or feel guilty about it or sort of wish he could. Jesus Christ did, you see, control his mind and his body every day with no exceptions. And the only decent, clean, pure, living human being to ever walk on this earth did die And he died an ignominious, barbaric death so he could take away the sins that you commit and ease the guilt a little bit and somehow make you clean for a while. Now, we have made a lot of progress in the Church of God in the last couple of years, an awful lot. And Satan is obviously angry. He doesn't like progress. He doesn't like to see us grow. And he sees the progress. And so Satan has done his level best. He has pulled out all the stops this year prior to Passover, and he's done so many things, I think more than in years and years and years, I dare say more than maybe in 30, 40, or 50 years, to shatter our perspective. And he's accomplished that in a lot of cases in this pre-Passover season. He's generated a spirit of discouragement, and there is a lot of that in the Church of God right now. There ought not be, but there is a lot of that. A lot of excessive, awful guilt, where people feel just rotten and hopeless, and vaguely suicidal, in fact, in a few cases. And Satan has done that, you see, purposely to divert our attention from the true meaning and the awesome, awful picture of Passover, which is not of itself and by itself a picture of your sin. It is a picture, you see, of your sin having been placed on the dying body of Jesus Christ. So the picture is Jesus Christ and his sacrifice and the agony he went through. And not your agony. That's what a lot of you are thinking about, which is why you're blowing the whole pre-Passover season, because you're thinking about me, myself, and I. I have so many problems. But what about Jesus Christ? Did he have problems? Now, Passover is a picture of a sacrifice. Not your sacrifice, his. It is a picture of a human being being nailed to a literal piece of wood. And I will not argue the point about stakes and whether there were crossbars or how high the crossbar was. And we have brethren, basically carnal brethren, who will argue and beller and carry on about where the crossbar was in the stake, whether it was high or low or midway down the piece of wood. And frankly, I could care less. What difference does it make? All I know is they laid the thing on the ground. They didn't nail him to it while it was standing up, you see. They didn't crucify people that way. There was a long stake with some kind of a bar. I don't know how long it was, whether it was midway or towards the top. What difference does it make? And they laid Jesus Christ after they whipped him to make sure he was already weak and dying. I'll tell you later why they whipped people before they crucified them in that time. They whipped them first to make sure they wouldn't struggle, you see. When they put the nails through their hands and through their feet, they didn't want a lot of screaming and yelling and struggling and fighting. So they whipped them mercilessly first until they were already dying. And then the crucifixion was simply meant to be an example and to finish them off. Well, they whipped him first. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But they laid the stake on the ground. And then they had the person who had been scourged and whipped lie back with their back against the pole itself. And then they had them raise, put their hands out. And there had to be some kind of a crossbar. It may have been slightly above his head. It may have been more to the side. But frankly, who cares? I think that's a very carnal thing to argue about. You know, how long it was or whether the hands were like this or like that. I won't deal with that type of thing. I see no point in it. I think it's disrespectful in one sense to Jesus Christ to sort of make that into some kind of a major focus. They took long nails like spikes. Now you see the hand doesn't have a lot of blood in it. The hand is basically a ball of muscles and tendons and ligaments and that type of thing. And the muscles and tendons are very, very strong, so they literally could put a spike through the center of the hand, 2 inches into the wood, you see, through the muscle and that big ball of tendons and ligaments, and then nail the hand to either side of the body to the crossbar of the stake, and then nail the feet in as well. And when that was done, you see, with a kind of a set of pulleys, then they would take the stake and they would elevate it so it was straight up, and then they pounded it into the ground. Now, do you see where the weight of the body lay? You see how the body was hanging on the cross? It was hanging there, you see, by the hands and by the arms. And, of course, as the stake began to elevate so that it would stand up straight, those nails in the hands, of course, were obviously going to begin to tear up, you see, because the gravity wanted to pull the hand, you see, completely through the nails, so the nails would come out the center of the fingers and the body would drop to the ground. That's what normally would happen if The hands didn't have those strong, very powerful muscles. There are strong, strong ligaments. We use the hands continuously, and those ligaments and muscles do not tend to break. So even though there was ripping, you see, in the hands as that occurred, the hands nonetheless stayed attached by the nails and the spikes to the crossbar on the cross when the crucifixion took place. Very few people literally, you know, fell off the cross through the muscles and the tendons ripping through those spikes. It didn't happen very often. But there was a lot of pain. Now that's what Passover is all about, you see. That's the meaning of Passover. Not what is wrong with you. Not your obsessive need to focus in on rotten, sinful human flesh. Now some of that is necessary, sure, but that is not the focus of Passover. The focus of Passover is when a group of young Roman soldiers, before they crucified him, put a crown of thorns on his head. Now, we've all had the Catholic, you know, mentality and concept that occurred while he was after he was crucified. It didn't occur after he was crucified. It occurred before he was crucified. And I'll read you a little bit about how they took Jesus Christ into a separate room after he'd been scourged. And they allowed a group of young Roman soldiers to laugh and to amuse themselves. And they didn't supervise it. That was quite common. That's, you know, what happens when you have a fox hunt or something of the kind in England. And they let the dogs, the hounds, go off and find the fox. And then you see, once the fox is found, they let the dogs tear the fox apart. He's just torn into little tiny pieces. It's a very vicious, ugly, barbaric thing. They call that the noble sport. Well, that's about the most unnoble sport I can think of. They had that system at the time of Jesus Christ. Before the dying person was crucified, they let the soldiers, you see, have at him. So the young soldiers had him sit down with all the, you know, the wounds in his body already there from the whipping. And they laughed at him because some people said he was the king of the Jews, and they made a kind of a crown. They took thorns, and those were long, long thorns, a couple of inches long. And they wove the thorns into a kind of a, you know, a funny-looking crown. And they took the crown, and they stuck it on his head, and then they literally jammed the thorns in the crown into his skull. Now, I mean, some of them went literally into the skull, probably into the soft, sensitive areas of the brain. And if you think that doesn't hurt, you don't know what pain is all about. Now, Jesus Christ went through the pain of feeling those thorns penetrate into the flesh of the brain. And he was not allowed by God, you see, to pass out or to get, you know, sort of dazed or to, you know, begin to lose control and then just sort of go off into some kind of a semi-comatose state. It wasn't allowed. God the Father didn't allow it. I mean, all his faculties were sharp, and he was totally conscious. Now, that occurred, and that is the symbol, you see, the picture of what Passover is all about. And frankly, because of all that took place then, you have the right and I have the right, which needs to be remembered as sinful human beings, to claim forgiveness, and if that had not occurred, you could not claim forgiveness. You and I have the right to claim reconciliation with the Father no matter what we have done, and you could not claim that right. You could not walk with the Father. The Father would pay no attention to you at all. You wouldn't know who he was. You could never address him as Father. You wouldn't probably even know that he existed if that had not occurred, because reconciliation with the Father comes because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Because of what occurred that day, you can feel, on occasion at least, from time to time, clean. And I don't mean sort of clean, I mean totally clean, to the point that you can sense and realize that you are in the presence of purity and holiness, and I'm talking about your purity and your holiness, because on occasion, that's exactly what the case is. Now, this year, a lot of people are running away from that, and that's why we're having all the problems, because we're not looking at that. We're thinking, oh, I got all my problems. You know, and we're getting all sobby and weepy about ourselves. I don't mind if you get emotionally upset about what happened to Jesus Christ. You should. But some of you who are, you know, sort of in an emotional state in this season are not in that state in too many cases because of what Jesus did for you. You're in that state because of what you are doing by yourself and for yourself and because of yourself. And there's an obsessive kind of an emphasis on the flesh right now. And that is offensive to God, and it is a reproach to the living Jesus Christ and a reproach to the dying Jesus Christ. And it is disrespectful to Him. Now, we're doing sort of what the early disciples did minutes after Passover. You know how that went. They talked together and been together for Passover, and then they walked off across that little mountain near the hall where they held the services. And they talked an awful lot. We'll read the words that Jesus Christ spoke this coming Friday evening as He walked across those hills. And then off in the distance, they saw a mob coming. They had lanterns and they had torches because it was night. And there's no way I'll ever keep Passover in the daytime. No way you'll get me into that, because that would be blasphemy before God. And I won't do it. Neither should you. It was night. And that rabble came across the hillside, you see, up the side of the hill, and Jesus Christ saw them. And they dragged Jesus Christ away. And when they dragged Jesus Christ away to His ultimate fate in the dark of that awful night, the disciples, you see, ran. They didn't stay. They didn't somehow sort of fade away a little bit and then sort of close ranks and follow and try to give some kind of support to Jesus Christ. They ran, in part because they were ashamed, and in part because they felt guilty, in part because they had a lot of anxieties, in part because they were just plain carnal at that point in time, and there was no way that they could cope with the death and the dying of Jesus Christ and all that was involved, any more than some of us can, brethren. Some of you can't cope with it. Some of you don't want to talk about it. Some of you don't want to think about it. Some of you want nothing to do with it. Some of you have said, I am not going to Passover. How dare you make such a statement? How dare you say, I can't go to Passover because of this or because of that? You know what you say when you make that kind of a statement? Do you realize what might occur if you don't go to Passover and do it in the right spirit? Now, Passover is a time when you look upon the reality of what sin did to Jesus Christ. It is a time to look at sin. But you look at what sin did to Jesus Christ, there is a different focus. Not what sin is doing to you. That's unleavened bread. That's the next festival. You see, before you can deal with sin in your life, brethren, you've got to see what it did to Jesus Christ. Otherwise, you've got the cart before the horse. Before you can have the motivation to want to conquer sin and get it out of your life and be clean from sin, you're going to have to see what your sin did to Him and how He conquered sin and how He removed sin and how He conquered the power of Satan the devil through dying on that cross. And when you begin to put that in right perspective, then you see, you know that you've got to overcome sin and you'll have the motivation to do it, otherwise you won't. You'll just get all overwhelmed with it and want to give up because it'll look like it's too much. In the last month, I've talked to a dozen people who've told me they feel unqualified to take the Passover. It's been like an epidemic. We've made so much progress in the last couple of years. We've made so much, and we put, you know, emphasis on progress and growth. And maybe that's why some of us simply feel that we haven't come as far as we should come. Maybe that's why. And people seem to be overwhelmed and submerged by a sense of their own sinfulness and their own unworthiness. And they see the power of their sins, but what you haven't seen is the power of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And when you see the power of that sacrifice, then you realize you can overcome your sins. But you got to get the perspective right. When people say to me, you know, I'm not going to take it, or I can't come, or I shouldn't, you know, I ask them why. And the responses are almost all identical. It's sort of like a script. It's like you've all gotten together and sort of, you know, analyzed it, and you all come out with the exact same words. I can tell you what people say, almost verbatim. People look at you and they say, well, I've been analyzing my sins. And of course, I can't correct you on that. You should. But this is not the season when that is all you do. That's okay. But unleavened bread is the season when you really zero in on sin. Once you see at Passover what sin did to Jesus Christ, once you have the hope of forgiveness and the hope of reconciliation, once you understand how great was His sacrifice, then to zero in, you see, has meaning. To zero in on your own sins. Some people do only that. People say, I've been analyzing my sins and my problems and my weakness. Do you get the picture? And my trials and my lacks. Me, myself, and I, while Jesus Christ is hanging on a stake, and you with the other disciples are running madly in the other direction because you're all, you know, worked up about me like they were. People say, well, I got so many weaknesses and I feel so ugly and so unclean and I can't cope with the sacredness of Passover. I'll tell you about something today that is a whole lot more ugly than your sins ever have been. The most ugly thing that ever occurred in all the history of mankind. So ugly and so despicable that that event can remove and efface the ugliness and the uncleanness and the vileness of anybody's sins, because it was far more ugly than anything you and I have ever done. When I hear that kind of statement, the one I've just mentioned, my heart sort of sinks like a lead weight, because it shows how much some of us have lost our perspective. You know, Satan has blurred the awesome, awful picture of Passover in our minds. And he's diluted the power and the impact of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. It's been sort of diluted and cheapened in some of our lives. We don't see how powerful it was or how dynamic it was or how meaningful it was. So we say, I'm not going. That's an awful thing to say. Now, pre-Passover is not a time to analyze, you know, what sin has done to you. A little bit of that, okay, but not obsessively. It's a time to analyze what it did to Jesus Christ. I want to tell you a little bit later what happened. When those nails, those spikes went into his hands, in the mind of God the Father, a lot began to occur from that time on, you see. When that began to happen, a lot began to occur in the Father's mind, because the Father saw all that and saw the spikes going in. And saw the bleeding. There's not a lot of bleeding, though. There's a lot of pain, but there's not a lot of bleeding, because the hands are not a part of the body that contain a lot of large blood vessels and that type of thing. But, of course, there is some. And in the Father's mind, as that began, the Father began to realize, you see, that any and every sin we've ever committed could literally be nailed the way his hands and his feet were to that literal stake. Now, I'm not, you know, some of our brethren get so uptight about, we mustn't talk about the cross. That's Protestant. Are you kidding? Now, it is Protestant to take that stake and to make it into a piece of jewelry and to hang it around your neck or to stick it in your earlobe. That's Protestant. That is cheap. And that is pagan. And that is awful and despicable. And if you got jewelry with crosses on it, I would heave it in the nearest garbage can as quick as I could find one. I wouldn't keep it no matter how much it is worth. That is cheapening the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We don't take that stake upon which he died and turn it into a cute, sweet little piece of jewelry and hang it around our necks. We don't do that. Now, some people realize we don't do that and say, well, you see, we don't even talk about the cross because that's Protestant. That's ridiculous. You know what the Bible says in the book of Colossians? It says Jesus Christ took every sin that you ever committed, a big long note of guilt with a list of sin upon it. And the Bible says that was nailed. Now, it says in the scripture that his hands and his feet were nailed, but Colossians says sin was also nailed. And as those nails were pounded in the mind of the Father, he also saw sin. And every time you repent and you say to the Father, I need forgiveness and I'm tired of being the kind of sinful human being that I am, the Father's mind has got to think back. He's never lost that vision from his mind. The memories are still there as fresh as if it occurred last week. You don't forget death easily. A lot of things you forget, but if you've lost a loved one and you've been there when they died, that's something you don't forget. And other things you do. I've forgotten a lot of things, but people I've seen die, and I've seen several die, those things you don't forget. They stay with you as long as you live. And that stayed with God the Father. And as you ask for forgiveness, you see, upon your knees, God the Father remembers, and the memories come flooding back into his mind. And that's why you can be called clean and pure. Now, I tell you, if you really knew what Passover meant to the Father, if you really knew it, I mean, the hell the Father went through. He had to look at everything that occurred. He would not turn his head away. He wanted to. That was the last thing he wanted to watch. He would not allow himself, because of his own character, to turn his head away. Now, I don't know what was going through the Father's mind. I know what has gone through my mind when I watch people die. Maybe you remember things that have gone through your mind as you've done the exact same thing. And those are things that you don't want to watch, but sometimes you have to. We live in this crazy society where we hide death from people. Some of you won't take your children to a funeral because they mustn't realize that we are mortal, you see, in this flesh. And kids should realize that people are mortal. In the old country, in Europe, people die in their homes, in their beds, with everybody standing all around them, which is the way you ought to die. With the kids there, and the grandparents there, and the brothers and the sisters there, that's how God says you should die. Not by yourself. Now the father, you see, watched and looked, not only because he was concerned about his son, but also because the salvation of the entire human race, you see, was hanging at the end of a very tenuous string, and somehow he had to get Jesus Christ through all of that so that when you and I would come to him as we do, and we ask for forgiveness and reconciliation, you see, those memories could come back into his mind, and because of that, somehow, what we've done can be covered and blotted out. If you knew the hell Jesus Christ went through before he died, if you really knew it and understood it, you wouldn't hide from it, and you wouldn't avoid it, and you wouldn't fill your mind with your problems during the pre-Passover season. You would be thinking about what he went through. And you certainly wouldn't cheapen that awful sacrifice by saying, I won't come, or I can't take it, or I'm not worthy, or something of the kind. You would come if you had to drag yourself there in bloody stumps. Now, you know, maybe you'd feel a little bit overwhelmed with unworthiness. I'm not worried about that. Is anybody worthy of what he did? I don't think so. Maybe you come feeling unworthy. That's all right. But you should also come a little overwhelmed and thrilled with a sense of God's mercy. You need to think about mercy. You need to think about forgiveness. You need to think about reconciliation. Not your petty, human, silly, limited, secular, mundane problems and pursuits in this age. That's what Satan wants to get your mind on. A couple of weeks back, I talked to a member of the Church of God about his crushing inability to conquer some of his sins. And I had to admit, it was a pretty powerful problem he had. And he was depressed about it. But the problem that I saw was that he had lost his perspective and he didn't realize any longer how great was the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. He wasn't looking at that, he was looking at himself. Now, admittedly, he had a pretty big problem. I realized that. But what he said sort of shook me because it showed how much Satan had blurred his perspective in this pre-Passover season. And he'd rejected the sacrifice of Christ. I don't know that he fully realized he had, but he had. He said to me, Mr. Cathcart, what I can't pray. And I said, why can't you pray? I knew what he would answer because I've heard the answers before. It's like a scenario, you see, the same old script. I can't pray. And I said, why can't you? He said, I can't talk to God because I feel totally unworthy. He said, the sin that I've committed is so great that there's like a wall between me and God. And I feel cut off from God. It's like a gigantic, there's a weight over my head. He said, I've got all of this guilt, there's a wall. And as long as it is there, I can't talk to God, I cannot take Passover, I cannot walk with God. And then he said something which shook me because this isn't something people have necessarily always said under these circumstances. He said, would you please pray for me because I cannot pray for myself any longer. You know what that means? Sort of blew my mind. He had his mind focused almost obsessively on the flesh, on himself, on his problem, on what he had done. He'd gotten overwhelmed with it. He had this kind of obsessive, morbid, masochistic fascination with his own imperfection. And that's what went wrong with Peter, and that's what went wrong with the other disciples after Jesus Christ was taken. And things began to occur in their lives that were very, very unfortunate for a while. Now, what I want to say is this. Satan doesn't want us to look up and with awe and respect set our eyes on the sacrifice, on the bloody sacrifice, the writhing, virtually naked body of a young man who was only 33 years of age when he died. I look back on that now and I won't see the other side of, 40 for a long, long time if I ever do, unless God rolls the chronology back somehow. And, you know, you finally come to the point where when a fellow says, I'm 33, you say, ghastly, he's a kid, just a kid, 33 years old, that's not very old, that's pretty young. I look on that as a young man. I would call a man at 33 a young man now. I wouldn't view him as a peer. I wouldn't say, well,
He's in my chronological category. Well, he's a young man. Jesus was 33. And that's what Satan doesn't want us to think about. He doesn't want us to see somehow in our emotions, in our heart, in our mind's eye, the body of a young man, not an old man. I'll tell you, brethren, Christ could not have lived until he was in his 50s or 60s or 70s, because the death of a man of age is more acceptable than the death of a younger man, and his death had to be totally unacceptable. And an old man dying, as painful as it is to those who love him, we accept it because he's old. Jesus Christ could not live to be old because his death had to be totally and completely went on for hours and hours and hours and hours, and some of it dried and caked all over his body, and some of it, of course, was fresh blood. And he was whipped before he was crucified. So you see, when they laid him on the ground on that stake and began to hammer the nails in, the body had already been cut in the literal ribbons by the whippings. And then they had to, you know, he had to partially drag the stake for a certain distance in the ground. And of course, dirt got ground into the wounds and the stripes and the cutting in the flesh where he had been whipped. And it began to get infected because dirt will infect. And they're attracted by the smell of blood and decaying. And there was vinegar dripping from his wounds. You see, Satan does not want you to be looking at that or thinking about that, because he knows if you did look at that, if you really saw it, you would be so moved and overwhelmed with compassion and with gratefulness and with gratitude. Because how can you not be grateful for what he did? You would be so overwhelmed with gratefulness, brethren, and with awe and with shame. But you see, it would be shame within the context of the awe. It would be conscience, but feelings of conscience, you see, within the context of respect and with honor. You wouldn't just be dragged down by it and destroyed by it like some of you are when you look at sin only. You would be pulled up and pulled back. You'd be overwhelmed by the greatness of it all and by your own gratefulness. He doesn't want that because he knows what you would do. Then you might make a recommitment to Jesus Christ. You might decide to begin to change your life, and renewal and reconciliation with the Father would become part and parcel of what you should be doing. He knows that. And then you'd come to Passover if you had to drag yourself there in bloody stumps. Now, I don't tend to hold very many second Passover services, I'll be very frank with you. When somebody comes up and says, I didn't quite make it to Passover. When second Passover, I tell them, sorry, none for you. Second Passover is for those who are totally sick and bedridden, and I mean really lying in bed, just completely physically shattered that night. I'll hold a second Passover for them. But I won't hold a second Passover for those who are disloyal and disrespectful and have no awe and no love and no gratefulness and who fritter away the time or who forget the date. I'd hitchhike, I'd ride a bike, I'd get there, brethren. I would. And I'd be there the night you're meant to be there. Now, Satan doesn't want us to reconcile with God or get closer to God. He doesn't want us to stand before God clean and pure, which you can do every single day. He doesn't want you to start afresh, and he doesn't want you to break the back and the power of sin. Because Satan can only work in your life when you're a sinful human being. He knows that. He can only work in your life when he has bound you into a sinful pattern of life, which you will attempt to do, you see. He knows that. So you mustn't break the pattern of sin. And the beginning point, you see, to break the pattern of sin is to see how ugly it is and how awful it is and how despicable it is. But to understand that, you must stand with awe before the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on occasion and understand that. So, Satan generates the pre-Passover slump every year, but this year he has really gone to town. And he sends trials, and he fills our mind with the flesh and the needs of the flesh and the power of sin and the power of the flesh and what is wrong with you and your job, and the boss is probably going to try to fire you before the Passover. Guess who inspires him to try to do that? Rarely is it God. In pre-Passover season, God doesn't want you focusing in all that much on your job or your problems or your trials. Most of them do come from Satan in this pre-Passover season. And Satan does that so you forget the power of the sacrifice of Christ and focus in on the power of your own personal sin. And what you've got to do is thwart him and realize in this season, brethren, you have a Savior. You do not have a condemner. The death angel, you see, only destroyed those who did not have the blood of the sacrifice of a lamb on their doorpost. And God said to the death angel, be that a high-ranking demon or a high-ranking righteous angel, God said, you cannot go into the homes of those upon whose doorposts the blood of the sacrifice has been placed. And God said, when I see the blood of the sacrifice, those in whose homes a sacrifice has been offered will be protected from the death angel. Now, we have a Savior, not a condemner, at the time of Passover. You've got to remember that and remember his sacrifice. Turn to 1 Corinthians 11, if you would, please. Who can come to Passover? Who should come? Those who are perfect in mind and body and character. What do you look at and what do you analyze? We must examine ourselves. What do we examine? What do we examine? What is the frame of reference? Verse 20 of 1 Corinthians 11. Remember, this was written just a few days after Passover had occurred back in Corinth. And you can prove that chronologically. It's verifiable in the context. And they kept the Passover unworthily that year in Corinth. It had not been kept the way it should have been kept. And I'll tell you why. Satan had systematically tried to blur the meaning of the Passover then, as he has this year, as he does every year. And he'd managed to get their eyes in Corinth off of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and onto themselves and onto human pursuits and onto internal church squabbles, because they were all fighting and squabbling, and Satan will use that as well, and doctrinal hang-ups and the flesh and some pretty silly ideas. And some very bad things happened that year. And the Passover became a church social event like a potluck. And they were laughing and living it up and having a gay old time, enjoying themselves. Verse 20, it was a fun evening. And, you know, they threw in the bread and the wine at the end, sure, but they because they prided themselves on obeying God. But it was an afterthought and it was an awful thing. Now, you know, Satan has done his best over the centuries to turn Passover into anything and everything except that which God purposely designed it to be, which is a memorial of the last agony of Jesus Christ. I will repeat that. It was designed by God to be a memorial of the last agony of Jesus Christ. And when it is that memorial, then the automatic result of Passover, you see, is recommitment to God, to the Father. It is reconciliation to God. It is a renewed vision of how great God is, because you see how willing he was in an act of total, pure, selfless love to substitute his life for your life and for what you have done, so that we could break the back of sin and see how awful it is and be reconciled to the Father, and, you know, to escape all these polluted things that Satan has brought into being because of sins. Now, verse 20 in 1 Corinthians 11, you'll see what occurred in Corinth that year, and it was an awful thing. He said, when you come together into one place, verse 20, this isn't to keep the Lord's Supper. Now, that isn't what we do. We don't believe in that. The Protestants do. And my reaction is they have done something which is totally heretical, and it must not be done. We do not keep the Lord's Supper. We don't believe in that. We never have, and we never will. We keep Passover, not the Lord's Supper. And when you did that years ago, you disobeyed, you see, in the church you went to, the command of Jesus Christ. You kept the Lord's Supper, and you must not. You mustn't do that. It is not a meal. It is not some sort of fancy social evening, a potluck with a lot of fellowshipping going on. He talked about how they ate, and, you know, some of them brought food, and some of them didn't get enough to eat. They didn't bring quite enough for everybody. And they had this fellowship evening. And it was not a good thing. Verse 22, what? Have you not houses to eat and to drink in, or despise you the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not, Paul said. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. He said, my instructions on how to keep Passover have come directly from Jesus Christ. He said, I know how to observe it. It came from him. He said, the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. Notice, when he had given thanks, he didn't give the piece of bread whole. He purposely broke the bread. He broke it. Now, what does that mean? I don't give you a large piece of bread. I break it, and I break it in front of you. And I've got to do that. And he said, take and eat. This is my body, not my blood. Not yet. My body. He said, this represents my body. You know what his body was? You know what a body is, brethren, because you have one. And as the bread was being broken and shattered into small pieces, as he was doing that, he said as he broke it, "This is my body." He wasn't pointing to himself, he was pointing to the breaking of the bread, which is broken, or which shall be broken, for you. And it was. Do you know how it was broken? Do you really understand what the sacrifice of Jesus Christ is all about? You read 1 Peter 1. It says in 1 Peter that by his stripes are we healed. Not by what occurred after he was crucified. That's a little different. The stripes, you see, came from a whip. And the whipping occurred before the crucifixion had taken place. They whipped them before they crucified them, so they would already be limp and dying and their bodies broken and shattered, so the crucifixion was an easy thing to do. Now, he was whipped before he was nailed to that stake. I don't know how long it went on. And it wasn't a one-thong whip. Now, purposely, you see, they tried to whip those who had been condemned to crucifixion, so there was no problem in crucifying them. So they didn't somehow writhe and cry and struggle while they were hanging on the stake. It was too problematic. Now, the whips they used before crucifixion generally had 7, sometimes 8, sometimes a dozen long leather thongs. You know what a whip looks like? Well, it wasn't a one-thong whip. It was a many-thong whip. They had to literally destroy the body so that the person was dying when crucifixion occurred. Now, the whips had thongs that were a couple, 2, 3, 4, 5 feet long. And they were sharp leather thongs. You know the kind of thong your grandfather used to have to sharpen his razor? And he would sharpen his razor and this sort of leather thing looked like a strap. And it had sharp, sharp edges. And the edges of those leather thongs, you see, cut into the flesh. They would wrap themselves around the body, around arms, around legs, around the face, around the chest. And the thongs on, either side of the leather thong, it was so sharp that they literally cut into the body and they left what the Bible calls stripes. That is, cutting into the flesh that looked like a long, long ribbon, because the flesh was cut and began to bleed where the thong, where the leather thong hit. But that wasn't all. They didn't just do that. Into the thong, they did 2 things. At the end of some of the thongs, they put little lumps of lead, little round balls, about as big as a large agate. And they were embedded into the end of the thong, you see, to give it a little extra weight, so that when they began to lash and scourge the person to be crucified, the lashes of the thong, the lashes of the whip, you see, hit the body slowly and then cut even more deeply. And sometimes those lumps of lead, you see, would also embed themselves into the body as the thong itself cut across the body and would dig into it. And then when the whip was pulled back, the little lumps of lead would pull out big jagged pieces of flesh, but that wasn't all either. 3 or 4 of the thongs always had little pieces of bone on them. Every couple of inches they would embed little shards of jagged bone into the thong, every couple of inches, and sharp and broken. And then when they whipped the person before crucifixion, the bone on the thongs embedded themselves into the flesh. And then when the executioner pulled the whip back, you see, again, sometimes so much flesh was removed from the body, pulled away by the bone, the pieces of bone, and by the lumps of lead, that the arm could be literally denuded at one time. They said that a scourger, they had men do this who were professionals. Most of them were sex perverts. They knew exactly how to rear back and scourge the person so that they could strip the flesh off the arm with one strike, with one blow of the whip, and it was all gone and the bone was denuded. They could do that to the back and to the sides and to the chest as well, and literally open the chest cavity up to the point that the internal organs were visible from the exterior. Now, Jesus Christ went through that before he was crucified. Do you understand that? And the Bible says that's when we were healed. Not during the crucifixion itself, but during the whipping of the body of the only clean human being who had ever walked on this earth. And every time, you see, those stripes were placed within his body, and the bone and these little lumps of lead embedded themselves in his flesh, and he could feel, you see, the flesh pulling away as the body was being, notice the word, broken. Jesus Christ in his spirit, in his heart and mind, was praying and saying to the Father, this is how I reaffirm the ancient covenant of healing. I have always healed, but my people must know that I... and suffered this and gone through this so they can look to me and look to this sacrifice and see it and respect it, and through this substitution of my flesh for theirs, they can then be healed. He was not yet the Savior, brethren, not yet, but he was already the healer of all mankind. That's what it was all about. There had to be a memorial of that. You can't take that lightly. Was necessary to get you out of Satan's grasp, to get you to the point where you see you've got to conquer sin and get rid of all the stupidity and the carnality and the rebellion in your life. Because you see, he offered for you a substitute sacrifice that is so perfect. You can't get a more perfect sacrifice for sin than the one that he offered. That is why he did it. A sacrifice that is so superlative and so supreme. It is the supreme sacrifice that it can therefore, you see, qualify to cover any sin, and no matter how ugly the things are in your life of which you feel you've got to repent, all of that has been totally covered and there is no exception because his sacrifice was supreme. Now the Old Testament says, as does the New, that without the shedding of blood there's no atonement for sin. Do you know why it says that? You want to know why it says that? Sin is so awful and so offensive to God and so destructive and so repulsive that nothing can efface or remove sin from God's mind. Nothing can blot out sin from God's memory except a supreme sacrifice, the greatest sacrifice that could ever be given. And God had to, you know, design it. God had to analyze what could that sacrifice be. And he finally decided it would be the shedding of innocent blood. Because nothing is more unfair. Nothing is more grotesque. Nothing is more powerful. Nothing is more upsetting to a human being than to see innocent blood shed. It had to be innocent blood, and it had to be the death of a sinless human being who had tried and had struggled with himself and fought with his human nature and fought against sin and worked with it. And ultimately, you see, at the point, a point in his life when he had conquered it and he was proven to be a pure human being, then there would have to be a sacrifice. And that is God's fiat, and that is God's decision. And, you know, sin is so horrendous and so awful. Literally, the Father in Christ had to sit down millions of years ago. And they decided that they couldn't overlook sin. And they could not blot it out, and they could not inspire us to overcome sin in any way, or to want to overcome it, unless there was a supreme sacrifice that would so move human beings and so upset human beings to the point that we would see that sin must be dealt with, and that sacrifice had to be the sacrifice of a sinless human being. Nothing else would be dramatic enough. You know, it isn't enough to tell us, sin is bad, don't do it. You know how many of you would keep on doing it if God just said it's bad, don't do it? All of you basically would. Now nothing else is dramatic enough or potent enough or memorable enough or frightening enough or awesome enough to shake sinning human beings into an awareness of what they are and what they have to overcome and to build a recognition of how evil sin is. Except that kind of a sacrifice. If you turn over to 1 Peter chapter 1, you'll see something which occurred millions of years ago. I don't know exactly when. But the Father in Christ sort of blue-skied the problem of sin at one point in time. And long before man was made, they knew that ultimately man would sin. They didn't want man to sin, but they knew that he would finally, somehow. And somehow that sin had to be dealt with, and men had to be shown how evil and how iniquitous and how wrong and how despicable sin is. How? So they planned it through. 1 Peter chapter 1. They came to the conclusion, as you look at it, that the shedding of the blood of a sinless, innocent human being was the only hope. And if anything would shake us into reality, that would. And it has done that. It has worked. Verse 18, 1 Peter 1. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, and we haven't been, like silver and gold from our vain conduct received by tradition from our fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb. And notice, not just any old lamb, brethren, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. That's the Passover lamb. It had to be without blemish and without spot because Jesus was innocent and sinless and pure and kind and perfect and good, and not once did he sin. He didn't curse once. And some of you, brethren, still have a foul mouth. And that's a reproach to God. And I'm tired of that, and so is God. We've got to overcome the tongue. He never stole, and he didn't hate. He was sexually clean. There were groupies that hung around all the prophets back then. I mean, you know, there were people coming fast and furious saying, I'm the Messiah. Some of them were all involved in sex cults. Jesus had opportunities, what I'm trying to say. He never used those opportunities. He lived 33 years. He was sexually clean. He had never, ever, ever given in to a wrong sexual thought one time. Now, he was without blemish and without spot. You think about that. Notice verse 20. How far back does it go? Who verily was ordained to do that, to be that kind of a sacrifice, to be a lamb and to be slain. He was ordained to do that before the founding of the world. You see, God knew nothing else would work, would be powerful enough and horrendous enough and unacceptable enough to stir us to the point that we would want to stop sinning when we finally began to look at our sins. He was manifest in these last days for you. Revelation 13, verse 8. Notice what it says there. Revelation 13, verse 8. I won't go into the prophecy. Don't have time to do that. All that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb. Always called the Lamb in the book of Revelation. The Lamb slain. Slain when? Slain from the foundation of the world. That's when that was designed. Done in our stead to blot out our sins and to shake us to the awfulness of that sacrifice and its magnitude, to an awareness, brethren, of the absolute reproach of sin of any type. And that's what Satan wants to blur in our minds. He doesn't want you thinking about that. Because when you think about that, you see Satan realizes that you may somehow come to the point where you see the magnitude of that sacrifice, and then you will want to stop sinning, and you won't want his way anymore. You won't want it, you'll reject it. He doesn't want you rejecting it. So he gets people into keeping Passover, you know, at other times in the year. He'll make it into a morning service so you reject it because that is not acceptable with God. He'll get you into taking communion or the Lord's Supper. The Baptists, the Catholics, and all the others have got their corrupted version of Passover, which has no meaning to God because it is not a night service. It is not once in the year. It doesn't show the power of the supreme sacrifice of Christ at all. It's a wrong thing. You know when Jesus in the book of John chapter 6 said, unless you eat of my body and you drink of my blood, you have no life within you, what that implies? Ever notice in the book of Revelation that the church of God is called the wife of a lamb? You know why? You ever notice that we are told that the marriage supper is called to begin with the marriage supper of the lamb, and we're called the lamb's wife? And why does the church of God marry a lamb? That's a symbol of Jesus Christ. But when he is symbolized as a lamb, that is a picture of the Passover lamb and a picture of his sacrifice. It means this. Notice chapter 14 in Revelation. You can read it through all these scriptures. Chapter 14, verse 1. I looked and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Zion. And these people stand before God. Verse 4. These are they which are not defiled with women, with false churches, for they are virgins spiritually. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. The first fruits unto God, the end of verse 4, and to the Lamb. Verse chapter 15, you can read verse 3. It talks again about the song of the Lamb. Chapter 17, verse 14 about the final battle of Armageddon. These make war, chapter 17, verse 14, with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. For the Lamb is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Why is he called the Lamb? Chapter 19, notice again. We're told to rejoice, verse 7 in chapter 19. Be glad for the marriage of the Lamb. It doesn't say Jesus here, it says the Lamb. You know we're the only church in the face of the earth that keeps Passover when we should and the way we should, and we have done it over the centuries, and we have never stopped, and we never will, because we are the bride of the Lamb. And we understand Passover. Unless you drink of my blood and eat of my body, Jesus said, you have no hope of life within you. And what does that mean? You want to come to Passover, brethren? Are you going to allow Satan to stick some stupid idea into your brain and you start walking around saying, well, I can't come to Passover? You understand that we are to be the wife of the Lamb slain from the foundations of the world? And there is a connection between that symbolism and the Church of God and Passover that is so clear. Verse 9. He said unto me, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we'll go back to that very quickly. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26. Maybe we can notice a couple of points that will sort of draw it all together. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 11, you show, you commemorate the Lord's death until he comes. Or for whosoever will eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily, that is, without remembering the picture, without it being a true memorial, without focusing on the power of that supreme sacrifice, not in the power of sin alone, but where you connect your sins to that sacrifice and the focus is on him, not on you, we'll get to you in a couple of days during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. If you do that, you don't see the sacrifice, you're guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. You're guilty, you're not clean. You see, you're counted as an executioner, not as those who are the object of that sacrifice. You stand then in the crowd of the indifferent that look upon the dying of Jesus Christ and say, well, who needs that? You become guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself. What do you examine now, you see? Do we examine personal sin within the context of Passover? To some degree, sure, but that is not the main focus. Most of that focus, you see, on personal sin will come in the Feast of Unleavened Bread and will help you see some of those sins during that festival. After you get your perspective straight, then you know you've got a Savior, not a condemner, you see, not the death angel saying, I'm going to whack you because you're not perfect, but a Savior. What you examine is your relationship to that sacrifice, and you recommit your life to the Father, and you're overwhelmed by all that He did for you. Examine yourself in terms of that memorial, and so let a man eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eats and drinks unworthily eats and drinks damnation to himself, not discerning, not seeing, not analyzing, not having studied, not standing with awe and honor before the body, the dying, agonizing body of the Lord. For that cause, because we don't care in certain cases, because it's our job and our marriage problem and our kids and our personal sins that have dragged us down. We've not discerned the body of the Lord the way we should. Many are weak and sickly among you and many sleep. If we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, and it's a good thing that we are, we're chastened of the Lord with love and patience, obviously, that we should not be condemned with the world. The time we have left, I want to help you discern the Lord's body. That's my reason for giving this sermon on this last Sabbath before Passover. And maybe you can get some new perspective, brethren, and acquire some new respect for Jesus Christ and begin to renew your commitment to God the Father. During the liberal era, we refer to so often, a lot of ministers began to teach that Passover should be called or was called the Lord's Supper, and that began to make the rounds out in the field. It was even taught in headquarters for a little while by some who are gone now. And while that held sway, Passover sort of became Protestantized and minimized and observed in a rather indifferent, cavalier fashion. I recall going to Passover 3 years ago in Pasadena. I was very sad that I'd gone. I did not enjoy it 3 years ago, frankly, because the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, you see, was somehow diminished. And that was the end of the liberal era, and I happened to be there. It wasn't quite over. It was in the process.
But the service was over, we sang the final hymn, and I got up, and way in the back of the hall, you could hear a lot of giggling and laughing, and there was a group of young women, very cheap-looking young women, I must say, rather tawdry-looking, and cheaply dressed. I don't mean inexpensively, I just mean in a way that is not befitting in becoming a woman of God. And they jumped up, about seven or eight of them, in early 20s by the looks of them. It was hard to tell because they were so unbelievably made up, you could hardly tell what their age was. And they began to giggle and laugh and prance around. And I was shocked. And there was another minister there, and I said, you know, do we allow that? Shouldn't the deacon stop it? And he said, oh, in the last few years, we haven't put any stress on Passover being all that solemn. He said, it ought to be a time of joy. He said, we told people, you can get up and fellowship and talk, and that's okay. He said, you know, we ought to be able to rejoice. My reaction is this, brethren, can you rejoice when your mind is full of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ? Did Peter rejoice as they dragged Jesus back across those hills to his final fate? Was anybody laughing that was a true servant of God? There was plenty of giggling going on in that little hall when they sat Jesus down with his body bleeding and battered and stuck that crown of thorn in his head and stripped him naked and put a reed in his hand and said, Hail, King of the Jews! But nobody who was worth anything to Jesus Christ was laughing it up. Now, if your mind is full of the horror of those final hours and you've waded through the scriptures about it, there's no laughing going on. I'm glad all of that liberal garbage has been swept out of the church of God, because it was garbage and it hurt human beings. And most of those ridiculous young women that were flopping and flouncing around at that Passover, they've all gone. You know, they just sort of slid out with it because they would not take the Passover seriously and the sacrifice. They hadn't discerned the Lord's body. They hadn't done it. They had made no attempt to do it. Now, I don't want this misunderstood. There are feasts of joy. The night to be much remembered is a time of joy. And the unleavened bread feast is a time of basic happiness and accomplishment. And, you know, Pentecost is a feast of joy. It pictures the Holy Spirit coming. And the Feast of Trumpets is a wonderful day of joy. And the Feast of Tabernacles is a time of joy, obviously, but not Passover. That's when you discern the Lord's body. That's a time of solemnity and gratefulness and analysis, but analysis of what he did. Exodus 12 describes that ancient ceremony in Israel. Type of what happened to Jesus Christ. And significant, when God forced Israel into a nation and he ordained them as a people to serve him and to be an example, that he also ordained Passover. Chapter 12 in Exodus. And he ordered the Israelites that evening to perform in their homes one of the most extraordinary, incredible acts in all the history of the peoples of this earth. And it was, brethren, I'll tell you, you know, a lot of pagan religions have sacrifices. But in no pagan religion was every male head of a household required on one occasion to bring a sacrifice by the millions all at the same time. Never that massively. It was done massively in Israel. Chapter 12. And it was a horrible kind of a thing. It frightened some of them and repelled some and made some of them physically sick. But it had to be done because that event portrayed, as no other event ever has, except the fulfillment of the type, the death of the Lamb of God, the living Jesus Christ. And you know, the only hope of destroying sin and the power of sin on all levels is the offering of the sacrifice of one totally pure, sinless human being. And God began to teach the Israelites that lesson in this specific chapter. He began to teach it via a type. Chapter 12, verse 1. The Eternal spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. This shall be the first month of the year. Now, prior to that, the first month of the year was in the fall. And, you know, the calendar began in the fall. And Adam was probably created, as far as we know, in the fall of the year. And Jesus Christ was born in the fall. And Jesus Christ will return in the fall. And consistently, the civil year of God has begun in the fall. But here in Israel, God said, I am going to reestablish the year, change New Year's from the fall to the spring. Now, you notice the Jews keep New Year's to this day in the fall. They should not, but they do. We keep ours in the spring. The last Saturday evening was New Year's evening. Did you know that? And if you go out and scream Happy New Year's, you know, on the street in your neighborhood, set off firecrackers, nobody? Why didn't you? It was New Year's. Well, your neighbors wouldn't understand, obviously. Seems one of my kids ran outside and yelled Happy New Year's, as I remember. Anyway, they threatened to do that. But last Saturday evening was New Year's, and last Sunday was the first day of the year. That was New Year's Day, you see. And, you know, no rose parades, no nothing, I guess, because nobody but us knows this. Nobody. Nobody, even the Jews, refuse to do this and continue on in their rebellion, keeping it in the fall. You go into the Jewish neighborhoods, Fairfax downtown, and Happy New Year's cards are all out in the fall. We're keeping tabernacles and trumpets and the fall festivals. They're saying Happy New Year to each other, and they should not do that. They should do it in the spring. Nobody else does it, including the Jews. We do this. We must do this. This month is the beginning of months. Amen. That's what we do. The first month of the year to you. Verse 3. Speak to the congregation, saying, in the tenth day of the month you take a lamb, according to the house of your fathers, a lamb for a house. Every single house had to have a lamb. Now they took it on the tenth day, brethren. Notice that. The household is too little for the lamb. Let him and his neighbor next under the house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make you count for the lamb. And notice they had to keep the lamb for 4 days. They took it the tenth day. They kept it in their homes until the 14th day because, you see, for those 4 days, they had to analyze the lamb. They had to supervise the lamb. They had to focus in on the lamb and study its body to make sure there was no blemish and no defect and no limb missing and no sickness. They could not sacrifice a sick lamb. They could not sacrifice a lamb with scabies. They had to analyze its body, go through its little furry body inch by inch to see if there was anything wrong with it. They had 4 days to analyze the lamb. Now, do you see the point, brethren? You see what some of you have missed? You see where their focus was? God did not say, analyze yourselves and do nothing but analyze yourself. We have to do some of that, of course. He said the lamb is the focus. 4 days, the lamb is penned by the house. Keep it there. And they analyzed this little tiny lamb. The focus was on that. Verse 5, your lamb shall be without blemish, that is, physically clean, because it had to be a type of purity. A physical, perfect physical specimen. A male in his first year, that is, a baby lamb. A little one. And there's something, that repels us in the death of the young. When the young of a species is killed, we're upset. The death of the baby seals upsets human beings because baby seals are little and cute and defenseless. The death of an old 10-year-old, big, fat, gray female seal out on an ice floe someplace doesn't interest anybody. Any movement out to stop the killing of adult gray seals? No. Little white baby seals, because instinctively we recoil at the death of the young. The young must not die. The young of the human species, we feel, mustn't die. A young man mustn't die in his prime. A lamb shouldn't die. Somehow in our minds, we feel repelled by that type of thing. And of course, that's exactly what God wanted. They had to feel that repulsion somehow because they had to see the greatness of the sacrifice of the living Jesus Christ as he died. A young male. Jesus was only 33. Now, some of them stood there. Notice what it says. You shall keep it up until the 14th day, and the whole assembly of the congregation shall kill it in their homes in the evening. I don't know how many of those men were sort of sensitive about things like that. They had to do it anyway. I'm sure a lot of them stood there for 10, 15, 20 minutes with the knife in their hand and that bleeding little lamb in their house with their kids in the corner crying. The kids had to watch this, brethren. The women had to watch it. The men did it. But the women stood and watched. The children stood and watched, and in every house, with a very few exceptions across the nation of ancient Israel, in the land of Goshen in Egypt, a lamb died. And the men had to take care of the job. Now, I've stood there when hogs have been butchered. I don't like doing things like that. I'm very grateful that the final type has arrived, and the dying Jesus Christ fulfilled the picture. And I don't have to do this, but they had to do it. In every house they had to do it, in the evening, not in the morning. And you shall take of the blood, verse 7, and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein you shall eat it. And you shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread and with bitter herbs. They shall eat it, which is a type of suffering, the herbs I mean. Eat not of it raw or sodden with water, that is, don't eat it boiled, but roast it with fire. The head with the legs and with the pertness thereof, and you shall let nothing of it remain till the morning, and that which remains of it, until the morning you shall burn with fire, and you shall eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, with your staff in your hand, with your mouth shut. Notice, you shall eat it in haste. soberly, respectfully, yes. You know, no yakking, no fellowshipping, no bouncing and prancing around. Those ridiculous young women wrecked my Passover. I'll tell you, I went home all upset. They didn't do that then. We don't do that now. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. It is the Lord's time of inspection. It is the time when the Lord inspects, passes over the land. For I will pass through over the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, men and beasts. And against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be unto you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, it doesn't say when I see the perfect people inside the houses. I'm glad it didn't say that, because all of us would be in trouble if it did. When I see the blood, a type of forgiveness and atonement and a type of the perfect sacrifice of Jesus Christ, when I see respect for that sacrifice and obedience to what I have said, when I see the blood upon the houses, when I see it, I will pass over you, and the plague will not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. For this will be a memorial unto you. And Moses called, verse 21, for the elders, and said, draw out and take unto you a lamb, and kill the Passover, and take a bunch of hyssop, and dip it in a basin, and take the blood, and strike it on the doorpost of the houses. For God will pass through the land this night, verse 23. And when he sees the blood upon the lintel and upon the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door, and he will not allow the death angel to come into your houses to destroy you. And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to you and to your sons forever. And we do that, brethren, because we are the people of God. In Egypt they died. They didn't die in the homes of the Israelites. You know, Passover is a time of judgment too. Did you know the blood of Christ cleanses from all sin? It blots out transgression. It reconciles us to God. It also gives us a promise of protection from judgment and the working of the death angel. When the death angel again begins to pass over the land of Israel, and it will, and I will not, you know, quibble about, is it a demon, is it an angel? All I know is it exists, it was there then. And you see, the blood of the sacrifice was a sign of God's righteous judgment and protection. And God said to that death angel, when you see that sacrifice, when it has been offered and has been respected, do not enter into that house. Now, has God changed? You need Passover in 1981 a little bit more than you needed Passover in 1980. I think so. Matthew chapter 26, we'll read a few scriptures before we close. Matthew chapter 26. There's a pre-Passover focus here I want you to see, and something you need to be doing as Passover draws nigh. Chapter 26, the centuries went by. They kept on keeping Passover. Finally, the night came when Jesus knew that he had a few days left to live. It came to pass in Matthew 26, when Jesus had finished all of these things, he said to his disciples, you know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified. Now, a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment, and poured it upon his head as he sat at meat. This was an act of pure worship to Jesus Christ. When his disciples saw it, they were indignant, because, you see, he was talking about dying. He was talking about the fact that he wouldn't be with them, you know, a few days down the line. They were very worried and insecure. They were worried about money and whether they would have the funds to live and to eat. And they were indignant, saying, to what purpose is all of this waste? This was just before he died. For this ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. And when Jesus understood this, he said unto them, why do you trouble the woman? For she has wrought a good work upon me. It was an act of respect and honor and giving. She knew he was going to be dying soon. For you have the poor always with you, but me you have not always. That was true. For in that she has poured the ointment upon my body, she did it in her mind for my burial, you see. She was moved by his teaching. She knew he was going to die. She understood that. She respected him. She loved him. She wasn't all full of anxiety because he was going to be leaving. She wasn't the way the others were, thinking about herself. She bought the ointment. She brought the alabaster box. She poured it upon him in symbol, in preparation for the Passover. Verily I say unto you, at this, wherever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this that this woman has done be told for a memorial of her. Well, I've done that this day because it is a pre-Passover memorial, brethren. Some of you who are all wrapped up in yourself and have your heart and your mind all involved in what is going wrong in your life need to bring to God an alabaster box. That's exactly what you should do in this pre-Passover season. That, of course, is symbolic. It is not obligatory. It means you do something as an act of worship to break, you see, this obsessive fascination with your own human imperfection, to break it to the point that you get your mind off of you and back on God. It may be an offering of money. It may be simply a recommitment to God upon your knees. It may be a day of fasting. I think it is time to respect that memorial and to bring a few more alabaster boxes of ointment to Jesus Christ. The one of them, 12, called Judas Iscariot, who went to the high priest and said to them, "What will you give me?" in verse 15. "And I will deliver him unto you, and they covenant with him for 30 cheap, dinky pieces of silver." The price of redemption of a slave in the book of Exodus 21, verse 32, who had been gored by a bull. And that was all. Cheapening of the sacrifice once again. From that time on, he sought opportunity to betray him. We'll talk about what occurred after that Passover evening this coming Friday. They began to walk in the garden. I want to show you what happened after Passover and after their conversations were over. Chapter 27, I won't read it all. I want you to reread it though many times in the coming week. I want you to read chapter 27 in detail and think about it. I want you to discern the Lord's body, maybe for the first time in your entire life as a member of the Church of God, perhaps. Chapter 27, the most moving story ever written. It talks about the power of sin and the power of the sacrifice of Christ. Chapter 27, verse 2. They bound him, verse 2, and led him away, and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. And then Judas repented, and he, took those 30 pieces of silver, and he said in verse 4, "I have betrayed innocent blood." He committed suicide. He was dead. Jesus stood, verse 11, before the governor, and he said, "Are you king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "You say it." And when he was accused of the chief priest, he answered nothing. He didn't say a thing. And then the people began to scream and cry out for his blood. Verse 23, they said, "Let him be crucified." There were mobs there. Pilate saw that, verse 24, he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made. He took water, washed his hands before the multitude, and he said, "I am an innocent man. I am innocent of the blood of this judge, of this just person. See you to it." And the people kept on screaming, saying, "His blood is upon us and upon our children," and that did occur. Then they released Barabbas unto them, and when he had whipped Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. I have described the whipping, brethren. You know what that was. He was delivered to be crucified. But before that occurred, the soldiers took him into the common hall. They got together with a group of other young men. Verse 28, and they stripped him of his clothes. There were no generals there to sort of keep, control of the situation. They were going to have a little bit of fun. They put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they jammed it upon his head, put a reed in his hand, and they bowed the knee and said, and mocked and said, "Hail, King of the Jews," and they spat upon him, brethren. He wasn't on the cross when they spat on him. He was right sitting on a chair down in the middle of all of them, and they spat down on him, and it began to dribble down his face and into the wounds where he had been whipped. And they took the reed and smote him upon the head. Then they redressed him again. They dressed him, verse 31. Put his own ointment upon him and led him away to crucify him. It doesn't say much about crucifixion. I've tried over the years to find a description of crucifixion. I'm going to read you one in a book by Frank Crumpler. There aren't very many of these around. Most people can't stomach what crucifixion was all about. I'll read you what he says. It's somewhat academic, but I think you get the picture. Crucifixion. Crucifixion. After, let's see, the physicians will affirm that the weight of the body against the arms, you see, nailed to the cross, fixes, that is, stabilizes ultimately the rib cage, and thus respiration can only take place in diaphragmic action. That is, the person that is crucified ultimately has got to heave his stomach, you see, up and back and forth, heave himself like this to cause the lungs to expand, because the rib cage will no longer move because of some kind of paralysis. And he can do that for a couple of hours. After a prolonged period of suspension, the diaphragm, however, will become fatigued, and finally that's the stomach muscle will develop complete paralysis. And the stomach will no longer heave upwards. Then the fastening of the legs and of the feet with nails. At that point will enable the victim with much pain to relieve the respiratory failure by providing a point of leverage to raise the body and thus alleviate the tension on the throat and upon the chest set up by the body weight hanging on the arms. That is, then you see the feet by pushing the feet up with the nails in them, you see, by using the leverage of the feet on the spikes, literally pushing the feet back and forth on the spikes. With a little bit of leverage, you can heave the body up and down a little bit longer, you see, and give yourself a little bit more breathing space. This prolongs the agony of crucifixion, and victims may continue to surge and plunge and heave back and forth in this way for hours and even days. When the legs are broken, the point of leverage is removed, and the victim then dies of respiratory failure, which is why they came to break the legs, but Jesus was already dead. Thus, the breaking of the legs is understood to be an act of mercy, not an act of torture. It hastens the death of the crucified person. Well, if you go through this, you'll see it doesn't talk much about crucifixion. They knew what it was back then. It's very brief in verse 31. And he had to carry his own cross in verse 32, drag himself with his body cut literally in ribbons through the dirt. Verse 34, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall, and when he had traced it out thereof, he wouldn't drink, and they crucified him, parted his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophets, and they sat there and they looked at him, and people walked by, verse 39, wagging their heads, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. Verse 44, the thieves also cast the shame in his teeth. They were crucified with him. Verse 45, he was there 4 hours, and about the ninth hour, verse 46, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because he knew that God had. You see, in those last closing minutes, the Father had been there through everything, and watched, and had seen, and had agonized in his own mind and heart as Jesus Christ died. But you see, the sacrifice had to be pure and clean. The sacrifice had to be innocent, and the sacrifice to be a supreme sacrifice, big enough and powerful enough to bear it all. The sacrifice had to bear the full weight of all sin alone, with no help. There could be no help given at the end. So at the end, you see, the Father did forsake him. The Father took away the Holy Spirit out of his mind. The Father removed the power of God from his mind and character. The Father turned his face away and wouldn't look at him. The angels that were there turned their backs and walked away invisibly. They were gone, and he was all alone. He had to be, otherwise the sacrifice would not be big enough and great enough to cover what you and I have done. I mean, I've baptized a little bit of everything, brethren. I've baptized men who have killed other men. I've baptized women who have prostituted themselves for years. I've baptized them all. And the sacrifice was big enough and supreme enough to cover every single sin. God did forsake him in those closing seconds, and he knew it. And the pressure and the power and the rejection of all that was so great. And they ran and took a sponge, verse 48, and gave him vinegar on a reed. And Jesus cried out, verse 50, one last time with a loud voice, and yielded up the ghost. And he was dead. I'm not going to read what it says in the book of John, chapter 19. That is also discerning the Lord's body. I recommend you read John, chapter 19, in the next week. Read it a lot. Read it through. Analyze it. It's all there again. It's the same story. The scourging, the horrible things, verse 17. He bore his cross, John 19, verse 17, into a place called the place of the skull, which is in Hebrew called Golgotha. And they crucified him there. And while he was up on that cross, by the way, verses 25 and verse 26, notice he saw his mother, and he asked John to look after his mother. And John did. Jesus was a poor man, by the way. Oh, Ted was wrong about Jesus being upper middle class. He wasn't upper middle class. He was of the lower classes. His people were poor people. His mother had no place to go. She didn't have this fancy house that Ted's book talks about. All the fancy houses and all the money that Joseph left when he died, they were not people of wealth. His mother had no place to go. He said, I thirst. It was a horrible thing. Verse 30, he bowed his head, he gave up the ghost. It was then that the soldiers came to break his legs in verse 32. And one of them, verse 34, with his spear pierced his side, and forthwith came out blood and water. And that was the end of everything. It was then over. And they came and got his body in verse 38. Joseph of Arimathea came. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17. I want to read this and I'll close. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 17. Paul wrote the book of Corinthians during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Chapter 5, Verse 7 talks about Jesus, our Passover has been crucified for us. He sacrificed. It is done, he said. This was in his mind. So you see, in chapter 1, he talked about Passover. He talked about Jesus Christ and him crucified. He talked about the sacrifice of the cross. We don't do that every Sabbath. We don't preach this message every Sabbath. We don't have to preach it every Sabbath. But this Sabbath, I had to preach it. Verse 17, Jesus sent me not to baptize. That's not the main focus, but to preach the gospel. Now, with wisdom and words, lest the cross, notice the word, it is in there, of Christ, should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross, that's all I've done today, brethren, is to preach what the cross means. Now, during unleavened bread, we preach the meaning of unleavened bread. And during the Feast of Pentecost, we tell you about the meaning of the Spirit of God. At this festival, and Friday evening, we're going to preach the message of the cross. It is to them that perish foolishness, God says. Verse 21. Well, maybe going on down to verse 23. We preach Christ and Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block, unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto those that are called Jews and Greeks, Christ crucified is the power of God. I'll tell you, brethren, that is the beginning of it all. When you accept and you see the sacrifice, that is the most powerful thing in one sense that can drive you and inspire you to deal with sin and to overcome sin. Then unleavened bread falls into place and it has unbelievable, wonderful meaning. It is the power of God and the wisdom of God. The foolishness of God is wiser than men and the weakness of God is stronger than men. It tells us to look at her calling. Well, you can read through that this coming week. John 19, the book of Matthew chapter 27. Before Friday evening, brethren, see the Lord's body. There is nothing more important this week than that.
Additional programs and literature available at hwalibrary.com.